Use the case studies in all sorts of different ways, actually. They're very rich, and there's a lot of information out there, and a lot of it's now very accessible with the internet, and they're fun in some strange way. So we use them all over the place. I use a couple case studies in the introductory class. I use the Challenger explosion and the Citicorp Tower in Manhattan that didn't fall down but had some very similar issues in terms of the organizational problems that the people trying to solve the problems faced. I make use of structural case studies in my introductory structures courses, and I use collapses that tie in the technical material. So I talk about the Hyatt Regency walkway collapse as an example. First as an example of what happens if you don't do your free body diagrams correctly, but then later on as an example of the result of some of the structural design choices that were made in terms of what the cross sections and manufacturing methods they chose, and in both cases really also looking at some of the designers' assumptions and how the designers ignored the fact that the thing had to be manufactured, that somebody was going to have to build it, and came up with a design that was really unrealistic. Do similar things with other famous case studies. There's other building collapses that tie into material. The Kemper Arena in Kansas City ties into some of the basic structures because there were some questionable design and construction and also issues and also some analysis mistakes that were kind of egregious that have to do with deflection. So they work well when students are learning deflection, which most of them don't like. So it makes it a bit more real. And there's some famous case studies for collapses due to buckling. The Hartford Civic Center collapse under snow, and a bridge being built outside of Quebec City over the St. Lawrence River collapsed with most of the work crew on it. In both cases, it was because the people involved had not correctly analyzed the buckling potential, which in a nutshell is, it's the best way to get a large structure to fall down very, very quickly. But it's effectively exciting the first harmonic of a structural member in compression, which is kind of like tweaking a guitar string with no fretting on it. And when you do that, of course, the guitar string just vibrates. But if it's a structural member carrying a load, it wants to vibrate, but it's being pushed. So instead, it just collapses and everything falls down with it. In our materials class, which is related to the structural classes, my colleague who teaches that class uses the Challenger and Columbia cases, those two accidents, and she also uses the World Trade Center Tower, because they're all examples of material issues and materials and actions and how choices on materials that are made in the design process flow into results when you start looking at the organizational impacts of how systems run, human systems run. And even something that seems to be well-designed and well-thought-out initially can run into problems if the system that's supposed to maintain and watch over it doesn't work properly. And the World Trade Center case also shows the very basic issues of how material properties change under different conditions, in this case steel softening as it gets hot, specifically. In the actual writing and ethics class, I make use of many, many case studies, and I use them in different ways. The ones I talk about, I actually rehash and revisit some of the ones I've already mentioned. I also talk about the Ford Explorer, which is probably my personal favorite case study because it's not decided yet. It's open-ended. And there's so many issues. There's issues revolving where does the designer's responsibility go in terms of safety for the people who are driving the car, where does the driver's responsibility start, and what is the driver's responsibility? And maybe the clear issue, but the one that isn't talked about as much, is what are the designer's responsibility and the driver's responsibility for passengers and drivers in other vehicles who are actually more likely to get injured or killed by these SUVs than the actual drivers of the SUVs who are still at risk. And a few others, but my part is just half of it. The other thing we do with the case studies that's fun is in a couple different cases we have the students go out and develop the case study information. And I use two different assignments that way. They're fairly different. One of them is in an ergonomics and safety class. and I give the students assignment to go out and find an accident and then tie what happened in the accident both to the ethics and to the Occupational Safety and Health Administration codes so that they can put it in perspective of professional responsibility both at the legal end and also at the ethical end. And they have to go out and find the case study and summarize the case study and draw the conclusions and defend the conclusions. That one's only a written assignment, so I'm really only the only one who gets to enjoy that, aside from the person doing it, which they usually do. Sometimes they get frustrated finding them, but usually they enjoy it. And then in the writing and ethics class, we use a case study presentation where the students have to go out and find the information and develop an argument as to whether or not there was an ethical issue, what the ethical issue was, and why the evidence supports the ethical issue. So they have to tie it back to the ethics, but they also have to organize their evidence and present it persuasively. So they go out and research a case study. Most of the time these days they rely primarily on internet information, but as long as they can get 6 or 7 sources, they'll usually get a pretty good idea of the case. And we try to get them to tell us right up front why it's important, what we should learn from it, what was done right, what was done wrong. And some of the cases that they end up choosing are very cut and dry. We have vehicle design students, so everybody wants to do the Ford Pinto case, which has a big smoking gun, and everybody knows the answer. And somebody always wants to do the Corvair case, which is very public, but actually much grayer. And the car clearly had some flaws, but it also has a very low accident and injury rate compared to some other vehicles. Some of the other case studies, I think, are very interesting because a good student can argue either way, like the Tacoma Narrows Bridge. You can make an argument if you have evidence and you can argue persuasively that the designer should have known that bridge was going to fall down. He had pushed the envelope too far. You can also make an argument that the whole bridge design field was going too far and that sort of an accident was inevitable because everybody felt that was the way to go. There's another case revolving around some of the crashes of the first commercial jetliner, the Comet 1, which was a British plane. And the way they designed the windows on the fuselage, they opened the plane up to fatigue failure. Cracks would form at the corners of the windows as the plane was pressurized and unpressurized, and they lost 3 aircraft. But nobody really understood fatigue at that time. So again, you can make a pretty strong argument that the designers did everything right given the standards of the day, or you could make an argument, if you're persuasive enough, that they did their jobs, but they didn't do their jobs as well as they should have because they should have been looking into some of these things. There were clues. And those are the fun ones. They're fun for the students, they're fun for the class because the students present them to the class, and they're fun for me because I get to see the different takes and different perspectives on them. The one challenge, of course, for those, and it's probably the biggest challenge of using the case studies, is I need to know something about all of them. So I need to be conversant in all the cases, and my list that I hand out to the students is about 80 cases now. And, you know, every year the students come up with 2 to 5 new ones I'm not familiar with. And they also come up with ones I haven't thought about in 3 or 4 years that I have to refamiliarize myself with. But I have to make sure that, A, I can ask questions, but B, if the student doesn't do a good job, I can fix the problems. I can fix the historical inaccuracies or the technical inaccuracies. I don't try to ever debate their conclusions if they're based on fact, even if I disagree with where they came from. But if they've got the technical part wrong, I need to make sure that the rest of the class doesn't walk away with a fundamental misunderstanding of what happened or why it happened. So that's a bit of a challenge, but it's a fun challenge because the cases are interesting, and there's all sorts of ways to get information on them.